Greetings, fellow Earthlings, and welcome to this tiny garage.
Any of you watching last week will know that we've now reached a point in this engine rebuild that's beyond where the Bentley manual will take you. Now, thankfully, Amber decided to come over last week and show us how it was done. And with that inspiration in mind, we are just going to continue. Now, we are coming to a point where we're running out of parts to take apart. And that means one of two things. If we open the case up and we find bad things, then that means we're coming towards the end. Or maybe an electric Carrera. Would that be sacrilege? Now, if we open up that case and we find good things, then that means we're sort of at the middle, and I really want to drive this car, and there's only one way to find that out, so let's get on with it.
First mission this week is to remove the oil pump. Now, I had no idea that this was the oil pump. I'm not sure where I thought the oil pump was, but I didn't think it was here. Now, there's two long bolts, those ones that are marked with white. They are either end of the housing that holds the oil pump in place. These are all 10 millimeters. Kind of got four of them around the sort of oval part of the fuel pump, and then two 10 mils at either end, and then another two at the skinny end of the oil pump, and then that one 15 mil that I took out right there. So those are the two long ones, and then all the others are the same length. There's eight total 10 millimeters in that oil pump. Now, that cog didn't seem to want to come out, but that one came out easily. I did clean it up. I wasn't sure if it has a front or a back. I put a bunch of Fs on it, ended up looking kind of like a runestone, but at least I know where the front is. Interestingly enough, that part right there, that is the end of the IMS that doesn't break. It powers the oil pump, even though it doesn't receive any oil from the pump, and that's part of the reason why it has a problem. Right, next, the coolant manifold. That oil pump rides within the coolant manifold. I presume it gains some kind of coolant benefit from that location. So here we are taking the coolant manifold off. This has eight 10 millimeters located liberally around its edge. Okay, I took off that little port there in order to gain access to that final 10 millimeter. Now at this point, I am wiggling and trying to figure out if I'd got all the bolts, because it felt like I hadn't really got all the bolts. Now that's happened a few times on this car. I am using that cloth there to try to ease the pressure on the mating surface for the water pump in that area. But in general, I'm not pushing very hard. I'm just pushing enough to see if it wants to move. In the end, I did realize that it's kind of rotating around a pivot point around where we talked about that IMS port being that runs the oil pump. And yes, that is the place. There's two black O-rings there, and I'm zapping that there with the WD-40. Plus anything else, I think I can get some capillary action and hopefully help me out. And that did seem to help. You can see here when I get on the bottom, that really seems to push it out and make me think that yes, it is ready to go. Okay, then just manhandling, really, just wrenching on it. And then there you can see the two O-rings, and that really holds that in place very well right there. That was the final struggle.
Hello, Tom Fitch. I hear you're a very nice man.
If you remember last week, we had a moment of gravity thanks to NASA's experiments up there in space. And take a look there, feel my pain. Now last week, I didn't know what that was called, but thanks to a subscriber, Bobby Mitchell, we know that that's now called a dowel pin. Thank you, Bobby Mitchell of Athens, Georgia. Okay, we need to transfer the engine back to the hydraulic table to split the engine in half. If you have one of those fancy-dancy Porsche engine stand adapters, you don't have to take it off the engine stand. You can split it on the stand. I don't have one of those, and so we're swapping it back over here. I did have to swap the reels around. If you're wondering about any of the things to do with the engine stand, check out episode 12. Hey, if you like these videos, please consider clicking that subscribe button. It does help. It lets me know that you want to see more of them, and maybe more of Amber. Talking about subscribers, we had a subscriber suggestion from Jordan Y. Thank you, Jordan. I was having trouble organizing these hydraulic lifters. The oil that is within them comes out and takes off the Sharpie that you're using to try to tell you which one goes where. You are supposed to put them back in the right place. But this egg carton, I had an 18 egg carton, and it worked great with that Gorilla tape. I feel much better now that when I come back to them, they'll still be nicely organized.
Hit the notification bell. It's up there.
Yes, please.
Okay, the chain guides for bank one. Now, if you're wondering what on earth this is all about, check out episode 13 around the 15 minute and 25 second mark, and it talks about what these chains are and what they're doing. Now, all we need to do is undo these H6 chain guide bolts. There's one on each of those chain guides now, and that's all there is. And then literally, they just come out. Looking at them there, definitely some wear, but there's nothing disintegrated. They are more or less complete. Now, if we spin the engine around, bank two has a very similar arrangement. We're using that same H6 to undo the bolt that holds the upper and lower guide in place. Now there's no need for that zip tie anymore, as cool as it made the whole setup look. There's the top and the bottom, and those ones, again, they're definitely worn. I'm going to replace them, but they're not disintegrated. Now on a 5-chain engine, you do have to take the engine apart like this, more than this even, to replace the chain and the guides. Now, I did mark them with Sharpie like that. I'm not going to reuse them, but that's going to help me find the right replacement and put the replacement in the correct orientation. Okay, the crankshaft bolt. This needs to come out. Now, this is method one. You whack on it really hard. You shock it, is what it's called. Up in that window there is the actual Porsche tool, which it's easier to find a picture of a chupacabra than it is to find a picture of that Porsche tool. So good luck buying one. So here's what I decided to do. There's more than one way of doing it. Whacking it with the hammer didn't work for me. So here I put the flywheel back on. And if you remember previously, I had bought in episode 10 this Volkswagen universal flywheel holding tool. This is an opportunity to test it out. You're supposed to grind it to get both teeth in place, but it worked really well just without doing anything. And there it was. And that worked. One tooth. Is that enough, everybody? Is that going to damage my new flywheel? But it did hold that one tooth very well, and for $15, I'm probably not going to say no. Now, the crankshaft pulley has a little notch in it to help you know where to put it back on, so I'm not too worried about getting that on in the right place. Now in the side of the engine, there are two bolts on bank one that hold the bearing carrier in place. Those are T50 Torx. And on bank two, there is just one T50 Torx that holds the bearing carrier in place. Unbelievably, there is more oil to leak out. Okay, we're done with that flywheel lock and the flywheel, so we're going to take that off again. Next, we're going to have to undo all the case bolts that go around the center of this block and split it apart. I'm starting here. You can start wherever you want. This part was facing towards the camera, so this is what we're starting with. We have an E10, which we haven't come across that too much. That's an external Torx, kind of goes around a Torx. And there's one above the RMS, or the rear main seal, and there's one below it. Then on the IMS itself, as it turns out, we don't need any of those fancy IMS replacement tools because we're going to be removing the IMS itself and sending it to LN Engineering. And they're going to install the new bearing onto the shaft when they pin the gears on the shaft, which is going to be something we talk about in a future episode.
You rock, Frank Nutt.
Howdy, Frank. Okay, now we're moving across to the top of the engine. It just seemed to make sense. Liberal WD-40 to help my case for whatever it's worth. Okay, on the top of the engine, we have 9 10mm. There's 7 on that main drag there that I'm working on right now. And then 2 that are up by the starter motor area. All the same length. All right, now we have the case bolts in the pulley area. The pulley area, if you stand at the back of the car and you open the engine bay door, you are going to be faced with the pulley area. It's the main part of the engine you see. And so here there are just 6 10 millimeters to undo that. Okay, flipping the engine over here. This is where you start realizing it's still heavy. You can move it around though. I know now from weighing the sections here that this weighs at least 180 pounds right now, which is about as much as a Russian grey wolf or a chubby mountain lion, just so as you know. Now down here we do have a couple more of those E10s at the very back, and then the rest of it is just 5 10mm. Now at this stage you're supposed to just roll it on to bank 2. I'm putting that rag in there to hold the chain in place. And then I noticed that I have a little thingy sticking out, a little proboscis. Yeah, it's not going to work. That happens to be the power steering bracket. You could take it off before now, but now for sure you want to take that off. 2 13mm to take that bracket off. Oh my gosh, here we are. We're rolling it over, laying it on bank 2, and we're going to pull off bank 1, apparently. Okay, I did hit it with a rubber hammer. That was really pointless. This pry bar, there's some great places, especially on the oil pan side, that are designed for you to pry from, and they worked really well. There you go. You see, that it really was that easy. Now, I lowered it in order to be able to have more pull on it to lift it up. This bank 1 weighs 43 pounds, but those pistons are holding onto it a little bit in the bore. Oh look, pistons. Oh my gosh, what do we do now?
Unfortunately, that's all we have time for this week. Thank you very much for watching. Till next time.
Don Esper, I miss you.